Dear Billy, I don't know if you can even hear this. 2 years ago, I'd have said that's crazy, impossible, but that was before I found out about alternate dimensions and monsters, so I'm gonna stop assuming I know everything. So much has happened since you left. Your dad was a total mess, and he and my mom started getting into fights. Bad fights. I don't think he could stand being here without you, so he left. And he didn't leave Mom much. She's taken an extra job, and we moved into that lovely trailer park off Curly. Basically, what I'm trying to say is that ever since you left, everything's been a total disaster. And the worst part is, I can't tell anyone why you're gone. I can't tell them you saved my life, that you saved Elle's life. I play that moment back in my head all the time. Sometimes I imagine myself running to you, pulling you away. I imagine that if I had, you'd still be here and everything would be right again. I imagine that we would have become good friends, like a real brother and sister. I imagined that we could have tried again, but that's not what happened. I just stood there and watched. And I haven't told anyone this. I just can't, but I had to tell you before it's too late. I'm sorry. I'm so, so sorry, Billy. Love your shitty little sister, Max.
He stopped believing. That's it. That's why he failed. He quit. So much talent, so much potential, but he stopped believing in himself. I guess all the stress added up to him and it broke him. I mean, his music was great. I would listen to it all the time. It would always get me into a pumped up and emotional state, and his lyrics never got old. But no one gave him a chance. He didn't give himself a chance. Maybe it was fear of doubting himself, and it crippled his ambition. He gave up, and that's why he hung himself in his studio. He couldn't do it anymore. It pains me because I believed in the guy more than he believed in himself. He forgot what it's all about. It's not about money or fame or compliments. It's about expressing yourself creatively because it's what your soul needs to do. He lost track of that.
I fell in love real hard. Justin, he was something else. He is something else. He gave me things I needed. He opened me up to the world. And then he broke my heart. Everything was taken away from me in one day. I thought I was building this wonderful life for myself. I was happy. I was recording. I was in love. I was barely getting by, but it was such a wonderful feeling to carve out my own path, to live my own life. But then things started to get the best of me. I started to lose my core, my foundation. And I didn't even realize until I had a meltdown. This one night, we were all out, the members of Justin's band and I, getting totally blasted at this bar. We just finished up a gig, and I was helping to load up the music van. But I started to feel kind of lightheaded, so I go and I lay down. And I wake up and I hear this moaning sound coming from behind the dumpster. So I get out of the van, and I go and look, and guess what I see? Justin making out with some other girl. I went ape shit. All I remember is raging. I grabbed some microphone stand from the back of the truck and started swinging it wildly around with the intention to destroy and conquer. It was surreal. Everything felt like it wasn't really happening. The next thing I remember is waking up in my bed, but when I tried to call Justin, he was nowhere to be found. Apparently, one of my music swings hit him in the head really hard, left a major gash across his temple. Could have killed him, for real. That's the last time I saw him. The whole story was told to me by Tom, the drummer, with a threatening message to never come near Justin again. So I guess that ended.
Do you guys know what I did to get in here? I taped Larry Lesser's buns together. Yeah, you know him? Well, then you know how hairy he is, right? Well, when they pulled the tape off, most of his hair came off and some skin too. And the bizarre thing is that I did it for my old man. I tortured this poor kid because I wanted him to think that I was cool. He's always going off about, you know, when he was in school, all the wild things he used to do. And I got the feeling he was disappointed that I never cut loose on anyone. So I'm sitting in the locker room and I'm taping up my knee. And Larry's undressing a couple lockers down for me. Yeah, he's kinda skinny, weak. And I started thinking about my father and his attitude about weakness. And the next thing I knew, I jumped on top of him and started wailing on him. And my friends, they just laughed and cheered me on. And afterward, while I was sitting in Vernon's office, all I could think about was Larry's father and Larry having to go home and explain what happened to him. And the humiliation, fucking humiliation he must have felt. It must have been unreal. I mean, how do you apologize for something like that? There's no way. It's all because of me and my old man. God, I fucking hate him. He's like this mindless machine that I can't even relate to anymore. Andrew, you've got to be number one. I won't tolerate any losers in this family. Your intensity is for shit. Win! 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 You son of a bitch. You know, sometimes I wish my knee would give and I wouldn't be able to wrestle anymore. And he could forget all about me.
Spare me your melodramatic bullshit, Emily. Who cares? Nobody cares! God, I'm so sick of your problems! Constantly whining over such baby things. Me, woe is me is all I ever get to see. My problems, my situation, me. Wah. You're so closed off from reality. You never take the time to move outside yourself and actually care for another living soul. No, you're never kind, never. Even when you show a sliver of sincerity, it comes off so put on and controlled because you start making these strange faces. Your cheeks and lips and eyes get all squinty, and when you smile, it looks absolutely insane. Your sincerity looks painful. It's so forced and awkward because you don't know how to genuinely be nice to anyone. You physically can't bear it. You're just born to be rude, just a nasty person at heart, always huffing and puffing and barking and growling over something insignificant in your life, and it's gotten old. Okay, so get out of your tomb. Live a little life, smile, get happy, whatever it takes for you to wake up.
Don't you dare smile at me, you arrogant prick! He's my person! I could save him, I could, even if you can't see that. And never, whatever, doesn't matter. I'll marry Dev. Worst of it'll be over. He's a good person, too. Kind to animals and children. Always smells like clean sheets. To love someone and know it will never, ever be returned. And to be loved by someone whose love you could never possibly return. Even if it was the last man standing. You know what I mean. I can see it. You're as lost as me, lost in life, and dismally disappointed that this is it.
I torture myself, and I don't know how to stop it. I try so hard to think positive, and I do, and I am, but staying that way, it's the hardest thing in the world. And it creeps back from the shadows of my mind. I mean, I do my best to ignore it, and for the most times, I do. But when it hits, it's a sudden wave of negative energy, and it's like a wave of depression. I get so down about the direction of my life. Am I doing what I'm supposed to be doing? Am I living the life I'm supposed to be living? Back and forth and back and forth and back and forth. It's a circle of confusion, and I feel like I'm going crazy when this happens, when I can't seem to figure out my direction and my path. It's like a disease in my brain. I get trapped in my thoughts, and it's a really dark and lonely place. And then sometimes I find the inner strength to rip out and reach a new light. And when I'm there, I can't stop but think and fear that I know I'm gonna go back to that way of being. It really scares me. And I don't wanna be that way. I just wanna be happy. I wanna live my life with purpose. And I wanna be able to look back at the life that I've lived and be happy and know that I did it right. Maybe this is something I should go see a doctor for, like a therapist. I mean, maybe they give me medication. I mean, I don't believe in medication. I mean, never have. But I mean, maybe I don't know. What do you think? Huh? How do I put an end to these phases that I go through? Because I don't like my solutions to it.
The only difficult one is you. You have problems. I was in the living room with the door closed, and I was deliberately talking quietly because I already knew you'd make a fuss. And sure enough, you created a controversy over the fact that I was having a laugh with one of my friends. It bothers you. My happiness bothers you. You're the one who can go upstairs for your studies. Why should I? If you have work to do, you should go to your own bedroom, lock the door, and do your work. I shouldn't be inconvenienced, and neither should Mom and Dad. But that's just what you do, isn't it? That's how you function. You make trouble for everyone else over the slightest matter, when it's you. You're the one busy making a big deal about everything, when nobody cares. I have news for you, Emily. Nobody cares about your drama. We're all just gonna go on living our lives, ignoring your stupid drama. So shout, argue, do whatever you wish to do, but just know it won't get you anywhere with me.
Yeah, man. That's why I'm quitting. The things that are happening here are above my pay grade. How do I fix Brent to stop being such a deckhead? And how do I fix Simone so she doesn't think that all of this is inside her head? Maybe I should drive her into the arms of my ex-boyfriend. That sounds fun. Or what about the demon monkey spy that punched me in the face? I'm not meant for this. I'm not the frickin' savior of the universe. I'm just a girl from Arizona. That's all I am, just a normal girl from Arizona. I ate junk food, I watched trashy television, I sometimes left H&M wearing more underwear than I had on when I came in. I did a bad job taking care of my own life, and now I'm supposed to take care of everyone else's life? I can't do this.
say this just to you. No cameras, no courtroom, just you. Because you know it's true. We allowed you into our home. We let you watch our granddad. We welcomed you into our family. And now you think you can just steal it from us? You think I'm not gonna fight to protect our home? Our birthright? Our ancestral family home? Oh, would you shut up, Blanc? Just shut up. Shut up with that Kentucky Fried Foghorn Leghorn drawl. Yeah, I killed Fran, but I guess I didn't, so what do you have on me? Nothing. What? Attempted murder? I get arson for the building and a few other charges with a good lawyer, which I have. I'll be out in no time. Then you'll see just how much hell I can wreak on your life, you vicious little bitch.
Well, I would say I used to be one of them. And then I came here and realized that these girls are smart and terrific women who are just trying to make a difference in the world. And we've become really good friends. I mean, I'm sure we wish the other one to trip and fall on their face, but oh wait, I've already done that. This experience has been one of the most rewarding and liberating experiences of my entire life. And if anyone tries to hurt one of my new friends, I would make them suffer so damn much that they'd wish they were never born. And if they ran, I would hunt them down. Thank you, Kathy.
Whoa, whoa, whoa. Hold on just a second there, waiter. Now, I wasn't going to say anything because I'm no marine biologist, but if she is going to order that, I'm afraid I'm going to have to speak up. Now, when I saw that on the menu, I did some research, and I am fairly certain that that is not possible. I mean, shrimp? Frying rice? The very concept is preposterous. There are a million issues I can think of. There is no way that they could get their tiny little hands on the frying pan, and I don't think that they have the brain capacity to know when the rice is done cooking. On top of that, there has to be a health code violation here. I mean, it says on the menu, warning, consumption of raw meat or poultry may result in food poisoning, but it doesn't say anything about consuming food prepared by meat or poultry. Look, I'm gonna be honest. I was fully prepared to propose to you tonight, but if you are seriously going to give in to the delusions of this restaurant, I don't think I can anymore. This is false advertisement, and I will not. No, I cannot stand for it. I mean, imagine walking into the kitchen and seeing an army of little crustaceans manning the grill. It's insane. It's delusional. The only explanation I can think of is a sort of ratatouille situation where there's a shrimp controlling the human cooking the food. But if that's the case, the shrimp certainly shouldn't be mentioned in the name of the dish. I mean, what's next? Manta ray steamed vegetables? Okay, now I'm causing the scene? No, you know what's causing the scene? Is the fact that you have shrimp preparing food. I have had enough of this tomfoolery. I'm taking my business elsewhere. A good day to you, sir, but a terrible day to whoever decided to claim that shrimp could cook.